Okay. So all who have not read Yogacarta Principle till now, it means everybody has read. Perfect. So Rakshit, tell me, what are these principles about?
Hello, ma'am. I'm sorry, I just missed it. I was outside. Ma'am, sorry, I have not attended class from last week because I had examination.
So?
I would really apologize now because maybe tomorrow I will, whatever
no,
work.
No, question is about tomorrow. We're not talking tomorrow. We're not talking tomorrow, we're talking today. Did you not know the schedule? Did you not know the schedule?
Yeah, ma'am, I'm unprepared today. I'm sorry.
Prashant? Kriti? Kriti has left the meeting. Amisha? Welcome, Avikta. Dr. Avikta Verma has joined our class today.
Hello, good
afternoon. We are happy to welcome you here, Avikta. Today we are going to discuss the Yogacarta principles. Yes, Amisha.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, I have read some Yogacarta principles to some extent. So this was adopted in 2006. It talks about human rights of diverse sexual orientation and gender identities. It's also deals with violation affecting persons of different sexual orientation and gender identity. So there are 29 principles which were adopted in 2007, and then 10 more principles have been added in 2017, if I'm not wrong.
No, you are right.
Yeah, so 10 more principles have been adopted in 2017. So Yogyakarta is a city in Indonesia. And that's where these principles were adopted, and there are a set of 29 principles. Shall I explain one of them?
Yeah, tell us the primary areas of concern.
Yes,
no, in fact, before going to the areas of concern, the way we looked at CEDAW, we can here also find out why, what has been the explanation given for introducing these principles. Why do we need these principles?
So the preamble talks about these gender, that we must recognize that people should have the liberty, even if they about the gender expression, sexual orientation, and sexual characteristics. It talks about all of these principles.
Whether Amish or anybody else, do you want to explain what those these expressions mean? What were the four terms, Amisha, you used?
It talks about sexual orientation, so it relates to the profound emotional, affectional, and sexual attraction to it may be either with the same gender or somebody from opposite gender. Sexual orientation, and then we have sexual expression and gender identity. Just a second.
So what is sexual expression?
The way we express ourselves, is what
in terms of the way we dress, the way we talk, the way we relate to the others. So when we're talking about expression, we are saying, yes, how do we, because we, when we say expression is not only the words used. Expression is all inclusive of how you present yourself. And how is it different from gender identity?
So, ma'am, gender identity is how society ascribes as to what we are. It refers to the deeply felt, those internal and individual experiences of gender. So while
Amisha, we
maybe
need to be
assigned
clear.
some
No,
other
Amisha,
sets.
we need to be clear between the two, the difference between the two. Maybe the gender, it is certainly what the society ascribed as to what is expected behavior of you. We are talking about gender identity. We are saying what this person, himself or herself or itself, thinks of, that who am I? So it is not only the descriptions of the society. It's also my own identification as to who I am. Am I a man? I'm a woman. I'm neither man nor woman. I am more man than woman, or vice versa. Whatever. There's a whole, we said 52 genders. So
Yes.
one can be
Sorry,
relating
sorry
to.
for that.
So no. Don't worry, sorry. When we are just learning to use appropriate words when we are explaining this terminology. But this terminology we don't use in our language, day-to-day conversations. So therefore, choosing the right words is important.
Yes, yes.
Yes, Amisha.
I just get messed up at times with these expressions, but I'm trying to understand the precise meaning with different readings.
Okay, who wants to add? So that's one reason. What are the other reasons? Why do we have these principles?
Ma'am, the introduction to Yogyakarta principle says that although there have been great strides in the field of human rights, but as far as the topic of sexual orientation and gender identity is concerned, it says that the response has been fragmented and inconsistent. So that is why we need a specific sort of rules or specific guide to tell the states what to do and in what direction to go when talking about these things.
It has also been mentioned there that when you're talking about gender identity and sexual orientation, it has resulted into a global pattern which is showing extrajudicial killings, torture, ill treatment, sexual assault, rape, invasion of privacy, arbitrary detention, denial of employment, education opportunities, serious discrimination in relation to enjoyment of other human rights. There's a recognition that it's not only that they're different and therefore the general law doesn't take cognizance of them, but it actually leads to a lot of active violence against them, exclusion of them. So we said that in case of women also, we recognize that no, human beings should not be tortured. But the fact that women were subjected to torture a lot more than men were, so that's where drawing the attention. It is not that other groups of people are not subjected to this violence, but these are much more aggressive and much more targeted to people belonging to these groups. So therefore, once we recognize that there is a violence happening to a particular group because of their social orientation or gender identity, then there is a need to address that specifically. I want to come back to this whole question about, we are talking about human rights to be secure to these people also. But how do you understand human rights? And before we come to the human rights, how do we understand a human being? Because human rights are available to human beings. And I do not know, I don't remember. Did I at any point of time ask you to draw a human being? I
yes,
did.
Ma'am.
And we had the discussion that you must have drawn either man or a woman or a straw man. So, and therefore, the discussion had led to this further discussion that did you put ears to, on there, if it's a straw person, whether they had ears, they had hair, they had fingers, all those details are missing in the straw person. In case of women and men, we are still missing out the third. There are mental images. Human beings have certain features. So whether the human rights, so when we talk about, what I'm actually aiming at is for us to have a discussion on the difference between human rights and fundamental and legal rights, whether they are the same things or they are different things. And what is the rationale for this? Why do we want to make that distinction that certain rights are human rights and certain rights are fundamental rights. What difference will it make if we identify, oh, this is a human right and this is a fundamental right? Yes, Aranya?
Fundamental rights may be a small part of human rights, because human rights, like fundamental rights, are also available to everyone. Like if you talk about citizen, non-citizen.
So what are there any human rights which are not fundamental rights, or vice versa?
Yes, ma'am.
Batao.
Ma'am, I think the right to form unions, which is also not available to foreigners. And I think fundamental rights are those rights which are, as the name suggests, are very fundamental for like living in a proper way and to like exploit the potential of the human being. And human rights are also important, but they are a little bit on a quantum less important than the fundamental rights if we have to compare them.
Okay. Do you, whether the rest of the class agree with that proposition?
Ma'am, I believe human rights are something that by nature we do not get from someone or some authority, but since we are humans, we have that rights because of our existence. But fundamental rights may be those rights that are guaranteed by a statute, and it may include some rights that are considered not to be as important by other states. So if Indian constitution guarantees some fundamental rights, the other states may guarantee different fundamental rights. But human rights remain the same all over the world, since they are humans and they need those rights because they are humans.
So human rights relate to the human body. So what will be the rights you
Ma'am, we can't hear you.
Ma'am, you were not audible for a while.
Now you are? Now I am?
Yes.
Yeah, I've changed the network. So what we were talking about was that we said fundamental, human rights are the ones which relate, which we are born with as a being a human being. Some of these human rights have also been recognized as a fundamental right. So when you say recognize, this means that somebody is recognizing. Human right, nobody has to make a legislation with, oh, this is a human right. So the fundamental rights include some of the human rights and some other rights also, which are considered to be essential, as Sayam said, for the full all-round development and growth of human beings. And there is a state action required, either in terms of abstention from violating those rights or in terms of securing those rights. Then we have the third category, which we call as the legal rights. So legal rights are not in Chapter 3. Legal rights are accruing under various legislations. So these are further, when you were to look at the hierarchy in that sense. So human rights are pre-constitution, pre-legislation, pre-law. Fundamental rights are coming from basic document in a country. And then you have the statutory rights coming from either in the constitution or from a statute, because the constitution also has two categories of rights there, some which are in other chapters and some which are in chapter 3. So chapter 3 certainly is securing fundamental rights. So I want us to go back to the human body and identify which are the rights which you think are traceable to the body. I'll give a clue and start thinking. So look at what all senses, what all organs, what all do we have as a human body? And whether those senses and organs and aspects of our just physical body need certain recognition of certain rights. Freedom of speech is coming from which part of the body?
Mouth.
The ability to speak
and mind
is coming from the human body, mind, expression, so all that. So try connecting. And Chayam gave us a good example of saying right to form unions is not a human right, but that's not coming from the individual human body. So reproductive rights, is this a statutory right? Is it a constitutional right? Is it a human right?
I believe it's a human right since it hasn't been mentioned in the constitution as a fundamental right.
I wish you also says human right. In the fundamental right, where it is listed, reproduction?
Ma'am, I think in gender neutral terms, it should be human right.
And why in the non-gender neutral terms, it may not be human rights? Men do not have a right to reproduce?
No, ma'am. Everyone can do.
So then why do you say in gender neutral terms?
I mean that it is not necessary that female can enjoy this right.
Okay, so I say the same thing that all human beings, it is coming from the body of human beings which have the capacity to reproduce. So, do we recognize today when we look at the law, does the law recognize this human right of reproduction to the third gender? And we are talking about the whole range of people out there. We are talking about whole range of people who do not identify themselves as either man or woman, as well as including the trans woman and trans man. You remember the distinction between trans woman and when we use the word transgender and trans woman? What is the difference? Who is a transgender in contradistinction to transsexual?
Transsexuals are the ones who have already changed their sex, like they have changed, gone through a surgery, and transgender are the people like assigned a different gender and they feel their gender
identity. Transsexuals are the persons who have undergone sexual reassignment because they were unhappy with the sex assigned to them. So, and the sex assigned to them had led to certain gender identity, expects them to have certain gender identity, and they did not relate to the gender identity because biological sex leads to the gendered identity also. So classification of that person to a certain sex is not how this person feels. So as long as you do not go through that, you do not relate to the sex of your own body, you do not think that's what who you are, then you are still in the state of transgender. And of course, the confusion happens a lot of time. Because the word transgender, which is an all-inclusive umbrella term. And then within that, we look at transgender as different from transvestite, from koti, from all these other terminologies that we've been using. So at one level, transgender includes the whole range of people, but in the limited sense we are looking at persons who do not identify themselves as either men and women or the third, or they are unhappy with the biological sex of their body and the gender assigned to them. So with that, when we looked at the reproductive right, whether these persons who do not classify themselves as man and woman or who have become man and woman through surgical interventions, whether they have by birth rights to reproduction. And reproduction, what does reproduction mean? Does it mean only producing it from your body? Or does it mean access to the progeny? And progeny may be your biological body, from your biological body. Progeny may be by adoption, because somewhere we have equated children by adoption also as your natural born children. So even though they are not biologically produced by law, for the heterosexual people, law has equated them as your natural born children. When we deny the right to have children, either by adoption or by surrogacy or by any other means, you know, IVF, when we deny all that, what is it that we are denying to them? A human right, a statutory right? And then they said they are human beings. So what is it that we are denying to them? And whether we have any justification for denying them the reproductive rights? There's only one example. What are the other examples? In case of, in the light of Yogyakarta principles, that we find that these have been recognized as human rights of the persons with different gender and sexual orientation. What are the other human rights which are denied to them? So I think we want to do two things. One, we'll run through the principles, what they provide for. And then we will try and see what is our legislation, to what extent our legislation recognizes this. And where are the gaps? So, okay, who wants to run through? What are the range of rights in the initial 29? And then what are the additional 10? Anju wants to say something?
Sorry, ma'am, no.
Who wants to speak?
Ma'am, so in the Yogyakarta principles, the first set of principles that were adopted, there are a total of 29 principles. Mm-hmm. And most of these principles are the principles that have been adopted by the UDHR as human rights. And some of these are unique principles, mm-hmm. which I found only in this document. So the first to 29 are, first is the right to universal enjoyment of
human. Ankit, I think instead of spoon feeding the rest, I think you identify the unique. Because they need to look at what are the UDHR principles already recognized. So let's look at the unique principles, which are only applicable to people with different orientation or identity.
Okay, ma'am. So, ma'am, the first one that I found unique is the right to privacy. And this right was also upheld by the Supreme Court. And this is a kind of right that the transgender community or the LGBTQ community has been deprived of very much.
So it's not a unique right to them, but they are unique in experiencing exclusion. Mm. So the right is not, because the privacy, right of privacy is a fundamental right today as per our Supreme Court. So a right which has been recognized as a fundamental right is denied to these people. And how do we deny that right? What do we do to deny that right?
In terms of violation, the right to privacy is violated much more for these people, because even law used to do that. When we said
so when we criminalize, quote unquote unnatural sex, we were intruding on their privacy.
Hmm.
Okay, what else? Which is the other one you find unique?
The second one I found is the right to freedom from torture and cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment or punishment.
Mm-hmm.
So this is from the reading Arvind Narayan that I found that almost all the people from this community have faced torture, have faced cruelty outside and also in prisons, in detention centers. And this is a right that I feel is not unique to them, but much more valued.
Most frequently violated.
Then there is the right to work, because even today not many institutions provide representation or provide job opportunities for people of these communities.
You know, when we are talking about jobs being denied, there is a preceding history because of which they are not able to, most of them. Because at the school level itself, for centuries, we kept asking, mark your sex, men, women, male, female. So they were not even able to get the necessary qualifications for them to get jobs. So unless you start from the very beginning, that unless you make them qualified, because it's not that once they become qualified, they will be treated equally. That's the second step. That even despite having qualifications, they would still feel discrimination because people do not want them around them. They think these are weird people, these are strange people, they are going to corrupt morality. So all kinds of biases, once we have that, so even after qualification, they will still have to face that challenge. But the equally important challenge is also that do they have the opportunities to become qualified for jobs? And unless we, and that's where NALSA judgment is very important, that it is addressing the problem at the first level, at least at the normative level. The other thing you said was violence, etc. And we did look at the legislation to find out that what happens in case their rights are violated? Nothing. Almost nothing happens under that legislation. So therefore, so that's you know, you're going to kind of keep on going back and forth. That right, and this is well documented factor, that all the rights which have been guaranteed to other human beings, they are the ones not only violated in the sense of the civil laws applicable to them, but also in the criminal justice system. So a lot of torture and violence happen in they are subjected to a lot of criminal actions. They are victims of a lot of criminal actions, but remedies are very, very exceptional for them to find. Okay, go further.
Then there is the right to recognition before law, which has been recently recognized in NALSA in India.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then there is the right to adequate housing, which I believe is not mentioned very much even as a human right, but people from these community face a lot of problem in getting housing, which people from the male and female gender do not face that much. Mm-hmm. In getting proper housing. Then there is the right to highest attainable standard of health and protection from medical abuses. That even in recent times also, most of the transgenders were, and most of the people from this community were subjected to medical examination, medical scrutiny, to get themselves identified as a particular group. And even this legislation talks about that if you want to change your gender once again after it has been certified, then you must get a certificate from the medical officer.
Mm-hmm.
Which the NALSA judgment does not talk about, which it declares unconstitutional.
That's in direct violation of the Supreme Court direction, completely contrary to.
And ma'am, then there is the most important one, right to found a family, which in UDHR was only guaranteed to men and women.
Mm-hmm.
Then there is right to participate in public life.
So how many of us in this class believe that transgender persons should have a right to family? Is it a human right? Is it a fundamental right? Is it our right? And what are the obstacles in them having, what are the obstacles which prevent them enjoying this right?
Ma'am, it's a basic human right to form a family, to have a family, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Irrespective
so,
of
so what country. So what prevents them from enjoying that right?
The society, the legislations which criminalizes, you know, which used to criminalize, for example.
Now, no, no. Okay, so today, let's talk about today. We do not have criminalization in 377. So now what prevents them to have family?
But we haven't still legalized the same-sex marriage, ma'am.
Good, good. Huh? Because once we say, how do we construe family? Relationship by marriage, adoption, blood. So the blood family doesn't own them. They're not allowed to marry. They're not allowed to adopt. So how will they have a family?
But ma'am, Arun Kumar case comes here, na? Usme to they...
Arun Kumar again said, you have to be a man and a woman. Arun Kumar doesn't say you can be a third and still marry.
Arun Kumar interpreted the Supreme Court judgment. We can also interpret that in a much wider sense. Though Arun Kumar judgment ne bahut wide kiya judgment, but we can also include then transgender and people with different. It's about
under which law? Under which law will you expand? Because he picked on the right to marry from NALSA, and then he said, "I am following Hindu law, which says man and woman, and there are these men and women." Because NALSA says you can be man and woman by your choice. But you still have to be man and woman according to Arun Kumar. So if somebody says, no, I am neither man nor woman, then what happens? Whether Arun Kumar will be of help?
Ma'am, but in one of the reality show, I saw one transgender said that I adopt a child.
Mm-hmm. Lakshmi also has adopted children. Will they be recognized? Lakshmi has also adopted children. But whether law recognizes those adoption? So because adoption is a legal concept. They are talking in terms of their social context. That yes, I have taken this child and therefore this is my adopted child. But will that child be able to inherit property without a will? The moment Lakshmi dies, her children will be left without any property of hers unless she writes a will in their favor. All her siblings will take her property. The law doesn't recognize this adoption. Though she has brought up those children as her own, they think that's their mother. But will the law recognize them as mother or father, whatever that case may be? Or if they know that Lakshmi in any case saying, I'm a mother, I'm a woman. But if this person says, I'm neither man nor woman, then what is the relationship? How will we even identify that person who is saying, I'm neither man nor woman? Are they mother or their father or they're somebody else? What is the term? Do we even have a term to identify this parent? Parent is a term. I'm a parent. So parent-child relationship. But beyond the being a parent, whether I'm a male parent, I'm a female parent, I'm an other parent, because parent can be male, female as well. So but certainly parent can be one terminology. But whether adoption law recognizes this terminology?
Ma'am, I think
this Sunday, I don't have that newspaper here today. Look out. There was this article in the Daily Times, I think on Sunday. We traveled on Sunday. So on Sunday, there was an article about the Indian prince who has married, I think, an American boy, younger to him. And the whole article kept on saying about, you know, from the perspective of the younger boy in that union, his husband. I said, but grammar seems to be going wrong. How can you have his husband? Constantly, I was thinking of, you know, taking a snap and putting on the group. But do a search, I'm sure you'll find it. So I don't remember the name of the Indian prince. Of course, a swell prince, but he's still referred to as the prince. And he's the only declared homosexual in the royalty in India. And he's well celebrated for that. But you know, for us to even read that article takes an effort to understand we have been having this discussion, no, husband, how can two men be husbands and husbands, this is a union. So the whole question that if you say they have a right to a family and it's a human right, then by can you deny people human rights by law? Whether they're not given by law, can you deny them by law? And if they are being denied, what are the remedies available for us as lawyers? Yes, I am.
Ma'am, I think what Ananya was trying to say about the broader perspective, it was something related to like in the Arun Kumar also, it was said that the person means a male or a female. But in the act itself, under Hindu Marriage Act, if we will have a look at Section 5, nowhere it is written a man or a woman, and neither a male or
That's
female.
True.
A person. So if we take.
How do you. No. Tell me, how do you determine the prohibited degree relationship? So will you say, okay, if there are two men marrying, then we will apply 5 degrees on both the sides. In case of men, it is, I know, forget, I think it's 5 degrees, no? What is the degree of relationship? And you have to go, no, not sapinda. For determining sapinda, you have to go for 5 generations on the male side, 3 generations on the female side. So does that mean that we are talking about man-woman marrying, or we're talking about woman-woman marrying? So if there's woman-woman, then there should be 3 on both the sides. Possible? No, it's not possible. But Arun Kumar was stuck on the meaning of the word bride and bridegroom. Arun Kumar claims that I am giving you nothing new. What we are asking for is new. I'm not saying it's not possible. But remember, Arun Kumar said, I am doing nothing extraordinary. I am only fitting the case into the legal provisions we have. And the legal provisions he was referring were very categorically men and women. The only shift he made was that it is not biologically determined who is a man and a woman. It is their declaration which will determine who is a man, who is a woman. But the Arun Kumar judgment is still bound in binaries of man and woman. Arun Kumar is not breaking the boundary. One can take cue from Arun Kumar and move further and say that once we have recognized that the understanding of this person's own perception of who I am, and it may be a biological man marrying a psychological man, so on the subjective type of side of it, both of them are men. So if we are recognizing that union among two men by reference to their own declaration of being a woman and a man, there's nothing different, subjectively speaking, in two men marrying. So one can take a leap from there and then say that, so it is expanding that argument by referring to the, and Ankit was very concerned about this aspect of it, on the biological bodies of the two persons. So if we start moving away from only the identity declaration of a person, so the identity declaration is also subjective, what this person feels. When we talk about the objective reality of these two persons, they may be both men. So if a biological man, objectively speaking, is a man, though he thinks it's a woman, and you allow that union in the name of transgender person having the ability to declare their own gender, then you are technically allowing marriage between two men. So if their identity is different, if they think that my identity is different than my body, you allow that person the right to marry a person of the same sex, objectively speaking, then you are discriminating against other people who are doing objectively the same thing, a man marrying the other man. And therefore, this will be violated by Article 21. So if you extend that article, so for me, Arun Kumar's beauty lies in this possibility only, that even though Arun Kumar is couched in a very traditional man-woman terminology of Hindu law, the argument has been of the transgender community that Section 5 just says any two Hindus can marry. Does not say a Hindu male and a Hindu female. And this I've been saying in my classes for a long time. So certainly, even though there's two, it is kind of come in the context of, you know, what we, there's a lot of knowledge behind the legislation. So it was assumed that when it says any two Hindus, everybody will understand it as a male and a female. That was the assumption of the law, which is being challenged because it is not specifically written. And that's what the law's job is about. That you start looking at the black letter law to find out what are the possible arguments there. So Arun Kumar made one very, very broad step, took one very big step forward by saying, even though right to marry was not part of the operational rights granted by NALSA, it was, by the way, made a reference to, by reference to Yogya Kotra principle. So here you can see the mechanisms by which rights activists broaden the scope of the law. So when you are reading these, when you make interconnections from what the law says, what the argument has been, what the judge has said, it gives you a tool in the hands of a lawyer that how can you examine a language of the law which has traditionally been interpreted in a certain manner and you want to make a breakaway from there. So what are the possible sources for building up those arguments? In Arun Kumar, the source was Yogyakarta principle, quoted in NALSA and used by the judge in this case. Now, for an activist lawyer to make a leap from here to saying recognition, because one, Yogyakarta principle has now been recognized in judicial acknowledgement also that, yeah, these principles are there, though not binding, but they're persuasive value. So using Yogyakarta principle, and we say come to right to family, then, and remember Arun Kumar is a judicial decision, but before that, they have mentioned to the Kannada case also, where the Inspector General did not object to the marriage between the transgender and the man. So in this case, the registrar objected, but court set it aside. So things are happening. If they're happening, and we have not declared that as illegal, then to prevent people who are not falling in the binary, even though recognized as human beings, we are then discriminating them. So do you think Article 14 argument can be built up? No, you can raise and you can build up an argument by reference to Article 14. When you start comparing people who are actually permitted within the new terminology, even though objectively speaking, they might be of the same sex, but somebody who then openly declared that, no, we are two persons of the same sex, we are not asking them, we are not allowing them to marry. Okay, coming back to the other categories, what are the other rights we think we have?
Ma'am, we have this other category now, no? Male, female and other. So when Hindu law says any two Hindus, so we can also include, pehle to male, female tha, so we used to include ha male, female ki hoga. So why can't we include other as well in that?
I'm still at the same question. If you are falling in the binary of man and woman, by whichever, whether by declaration or whether by birth, and that's easily handled with Arun Kumar. If a person says, I am neither man nor woman, now, in order to determine this person's sapinda relationship, will you go 3 degrees or 5 degrees?
I guess that is a question we should determine after we get into this, no? Because
No. This person wants to get married in a valid marriage. But within those categories also, we will still go by, you know, there's a rationale for sapinda relationship, no, prohibition of sapinda, that it creates lot of congenital problems are created if you marry within the clan. That's why the rule on sapinda. So if we say we will still follow the sapinda principle, and we're talking about two Hindus, so in two Hindus, unless you would now change away, not do away with this sapinda relationship prohibition also. So if you say sapinda, then how will you determine whether their generations will be determined by reference to the surgical sex or pre-surgical sex? So those kind of questions will still need to be addressed, na? So even if say it is okay, two people, you know, both of them are trans and they both want to marry, then one possible, you know, there will be a lot of possibilities. One will say, okay, we will, because the whole Sapinda prohibition is by reference to the biological categories as time of birth. Therefore, we will determine their generation, Sapinda relationship by reference to their biological birth. We've had this question in family law classes also, that if a person has changed by surgical intervention, their sex, will, and they have become a man or a woman, will they then be entitled to inherit property as per the family law as a man and woman? Is that Sayam raising the hand or Avekta raising the hand?
Yes, ma'am. I wanted yes, to know one thing, ma'am. Ma'am, the status of marriage between people of between two people of same sex, is it there still ambiguity regarding the same, or there is clear law that it is illegal?
Presently, we do not have any clarity. I think because of the what we no okay. There's no confusion. Let me correct myself. There is no ambiguity at this point of time that two males and two females cannot marry. That is why we have the High Court having three cases combined together. They're dealing with their petitions. The stride Arun Kumar has made is only in relation to those persons who are, by their own declaration, still man and woman. Biologically, they may be two men, they might be two women, but one of them thinks I am a man, the other thinks I am a woman. Either think or they are. So that is the union which Arun Kumar recognizes. So as far as people of the same sex, if they want to get married, there is no permission of that. But because in some countries, one of the petitions in the Delhi High Court is by a couple who has married in US and they have come to India. They want to be recognized as husband and wife here. The Indian law doesn't provide for that. So they're saying that no. So they are challenging. One is challenging Special Marriage Act, other is challenging Hindu Marriage Act. The third one is challenging the Foreigners Marriage Act. None of them saying that these are discriminatory. You cannot prevent people from enjoying the company of the other, or not only company, but they are talking about that once you recognize that family is formed by marriage, then on what logic would you deny me that right? Any other rights we want to talk about? We've got a few more minutes left.
Ma'am, I have one question.
Yeah.
Ma'am, on the question of Sapinda, can't we keep this choice open for them, for the third gender? Either they want to follow the three generation principle or the five generation?
No, that's a question. Because when you look at the Muslim law, they are not following the Sapinda principle. And I don't think that's even followed by Jews. I don't know what the rationality in Jews have been and what the consequence in Muslims have been. But in Jewish population, because they married within, they have this whole thing about marrying within the Jewish community, and the girls marrying outside become outcast, and only the men can marry and make the woman as part of it. But because of all these reasons, their population has decreased a lot. And they have been doing marriage within the kin and close persons, and they have been identified as having a lot of biological congenital issues because of that intermarrying. It has been proved, and a scientific fact has been. So if we look at the scientific rationale of having Sapinda, then giving choice to people doesn't work. Na? Then you will have to say, okay, because we are looking at genetics, then we will look at genetically who they were, and we will determine the relationship by reference to the genetic identity of that person. But now we are in trouble in genetic identity also to some extent, that there are certain genetic aspects of the body which are seen to be masculine but found in the female body, or vice versa. So it's going to be very much more complicated. So one can always say that one will have to certainly frame rules for dealing with those situations. You know, that it's not possible, but we will have to frame rules for that particular person. We can always follow the rules from any of the, if we want to take models, we can find models and traditions of different communities and religion. We can find models in scientific community, the scientific findings. There may be various parameters to determine what should be permitted. But the first of the question we were at and we were looking at examining is that what are the rights which have been recognized as human rights, but which are denied widely to transgender people? And so what is the rationale for denying that? And we went back to saying that progeny has not even in the Hindu marriage, inability to produce children. It's not a ground for divorce. It's only, and if somebody becomes impotent after marriage, you cannot annul that marriage. So these people would never be able to produce children. That is not a ground. Impotency is important. And that's not for divorce, that's also for annulment of marriage. If at the time of marriage, either the party were incapable of having sexual relationships, or whether biological reasons or psychological reasons. So that's what we have to recognize. So impotency means no ability, not having the ability to provide pleasure to the other, sexual pleasure to the other. So that has been recognized. Absence of the ability to produce children is not recognized as a ground either for annulment or for divorce. So if we take the analogy from heterosexual couples' marriage conditions, then there is no rationale for saying you can't marry because you can't produce. But there are a lot of married couples who can't produce. Do you give them any relief? You allow them to adopt. You allow them to go for surrogacy because it's a human right. If it's a human right for the heterosexual couples, how does it not remain a human right for the homosexual couples? So that's where I think it's a very important point to remember that we have all this baggage of morality, of traditions, of our assumptions about what marriage is about. But when you start deconstructing that, we do find that a lot of discrimination happening because we have our biased attitude towards them. We do not believe they are normal human beings. So any other point you want to make very quickly? We are out with the time today. Ananya or Ankit or anybody else?
I just want to make one comment, ma'am.
Yes, Saloni.
Ma'am, I have worked for 5 years professionally and I'm 23 years old. I have never encountered any person at workplace who is working or in housing like our neighbors who are like transgender people, neither in education, just in law faculty. There is only one student whom I met. So like they aren't part of our life. We never come to like meet them or encounter them. Like that make me like
even when you do. No. Have you never met a hijra on the street red light?
Yes, ma'am.
You've seen more than one person, but yes, we have never bothered to find out more about their lives. Not only this person's life, but on the general life of hijras. Have you ever looked at a book? No, we have looked up books on women. We have looked up books on masculinity. Have we looked at books on transgender, hijras? So most of the time, and even the one student you have come across in the law faculty, have you ever tried to find out what is happening to him in the law faculty?
Yes, ma'am. She has spoke about that.
No, she has spoken. And I'm not, when I'm saying you, I'm not only saying that you. I'm talking about how many of us have actually tried to find out what is happening to her and what have we done to ameliorate her problems? Have we had a discussion with the toilet? Just that simple, as such a simple thing. I think somewhere we are beginning to see that there's a problem, but we are still not opening our minds to find the solutions for them. The range of rights written in the plus 10 category. I'll quickly, I think perhaps I'll share the 10 more additional principles. I'm just going to kind of just read through them. You can read along. State protection, legal recognition, bodily and mental integrity. Maybe let me just go back to this one. This was found since the adoption of the Yogyakarta principle that intersections of the development in international law, human rights law, with the emerging understanding of violations suffered by persons on grounds of sexual orientation, gender identity, recognition of the distinct and intersectional grounds of gender expression and sexual characteristics has emerged as an important area of concern. And that is why we have this 10 added. State protection, legal recognition, bodily and mental integrity, freedom from criminalization and sanction on the basis of sexual orientation, identity, expression, or characteristics, right to protection from poverty. Well, that's a huge concern. They're not allowed to stay in the family. They're not allowed to find capabilities and abilities to earn their livelihood. They're denied. Even if they find a job, people find out about their difference, they're thrown out of the job. So therefore, protection from poverty is one of the important ones. Right to sanitation, enjoyment of human rights in relation to information, communication technologies, right to truth, right to practice, protect, preserve, and revive cultural diversity. What do you understand by revive cultural diversity? In the Indian context, very important to notice that at some point of time, we were much more inclusive than what we are today of the different persons, even though it was limited to the Hijra community. But today, even that is not acceptable. So I certainly think that it's important to recognize that now in international law, we are making strides. Of course, we are still very far away. Why do you think till date there's no declaration as yet from the UN? These are principles accepted by, adopted by certain individuals, human rights activists. What are the reasons? Why till date we do not have any declaration on their rights? What are the factors which are responsible? What are the ideologies which are preventing? And this is not to do with patriarchy. With that thought, try to find out if you can think of the answers, you can find some answers that what has been the obstacles in, or whether there are any steps being taken. Is there any work in progress towards declaration of rights of the transgender persons? That's a job. Some stage you should find that out. Tomorrow we talk about IPC. Not only IPC, criminal law, gender and criminal law. So I think there is an article by me and there's one by Usha Tandon. We'll try to have a quick look at those and we'll continue. Now we are moving on from the background understanding or the basic concepts in international law, which forms the backbone of analyzing the laws. So all this will be coming in handy to find out to what extent the gender neutral laws, you know, there are two categories of laws. One we call it gender neutral, the other is gendered. And my submission always, you know, continuously will be to highlight areas where gender neutral laws are gendered. We think they're gender neutral, but they're actually not gender neutral. And certainly the ones which are gendered, whether they are symbolic or they're instrumental. So that's the analysis we start doing from tomorrow. Looking at various laws, we are beginning with criminal law. Okay, attendance, please, everyone. Avikta, do you want to add anything?
Well, ma'am, I've not read those principles, but joined your class for the first time, and the topic is something beyond just when while traveling or in our daily lives, we do come across hijras at the red light and all. So it always made me feel why they can't be educated, why they have to live like this, why they can't get a job. But in your class today, like thinking for the first time beyond that, right to have a family, marriage, and all that. So never thought earlier on those lines.
No, I think, unless we kind of get to discussing issues connected with their lives, things are not going to change. There'll be no demand for change also. There'll be always this exclusion. So I hope to see
Exactly.
you more often. I hope to see you more often.
Yeah, definitely, because I realize I don't know about others, but if I think of myself, I do carry my own baggages, thinking for the first time, how can they adopt a child and all those kind of things. So never really thought of all these things. So it's a really difficult topic, requires a lot of thinking and analysis. Not so
Yeah.
easy.
As long as we start thinking about it, we'll find some answers. Not all the answers are. If the answers were easy to find, they have been found already. There are ongoing struggles, understandings, expansion of our horizon.
Yeah, more so because we have never really interacted, come across, and we really don't know their real issues, problems, the kind of life, and didn't even try to read about them. There are a lot of books around, but that is our own ignorance, maybe,
Yeah.
of all the issues.
Okay. So everyone, please mark your attendance. I'll stop recording.
Also, ma'am, congratulations, you got.